will have to bear with me. This is a very nascent subject matter. There is not much written about it. I didn't have the luxury of, reading up on Ogilvy or a Kotler or and sounding all intellectual. So whatever you're gonna hear from me today is what I in these years, specifically of IP being part of the IP team at BCCL, and of my larger experience of almost 20 years in the industry. My learning from that is what I will be able to share with you. Okay. Shall we get into the presentation, Lavina?
Absolutely. Yes.
Okay. Is this visible to
visible? Yes. Yes. It's visible.
Great. So, like the subject itself mentions, what we're looking for is the secret ingredients of a successful IP. I think the many agencies, many curators, many thinkers, creative thinkers that I have met in the past, almost everyone wishes to have a successful IP. What I'm sharing with you is my learning of what all can go into making one. And from there on, we can then discuss what all are the other things that I may have missed, many of you may have seen happening, and we can have a chit chat on that part of it. So I'll just jump into the presentation without further ado. The first point that I, just one sec, this seems to be taking a bit of a time. Okay, so just give me a second, guys. There's some problem with my deck. Okay, so since there's one slide which seems to have gone missing, I'll just continue with this. I'm going to take up amongst the few IPs that I have myself curated and created for the Times Group. I have picked up one as an example. I'm going to keep coming back to this while discussing the other points. So let me give you a very brief idea of what this particular IP has all been about. I'm about to play you a very short video. We should give you a sense of what Times Kitchen Tales has been.
Priyanka, we can all see and hear you. Yes, you
are. Okay, thanks. Sorry, I couldn't see anything. So I was worrying if I'm only talking to myself.
No,
you're thanks.
Visible.
Cool. Coming back to kitchen taste. So why I've picked this particular IP actually is to basically highlight the fact that, you know, this entire IP was created around food. Now, food is something which is hugely spoken about. There are multiple programs, multiple activities happening around it, whether on ground, whether on television. In fact, even on radio, where you can't either see or smell, but they have programs on food as well. So it's a often repeated product. However, the one place where, and in fact, even in print, food is there. However, food was there in print only in the format of showcasing recipes or a restaurant review, very, very specifically. What we were trying to do here was pick up food as a genre, food shows as a genre, and translate that onto a print medium, which is the medium we work with the most closely. Why I have picked this particular IP is also to show that, see, there's nothing unique about food, right? And there's honestly nothing too unique about the content that we're creating. It's just the way the content is being created. It's just the way the content is being placed. So something which is very commonplace is picked up and it becomes a successful IP for us. It's given us the right kind of eyeballs. It's given us the right kind of readership. The engagements have been fabulous. And in at the end of season one, we were actually given the Silver Abbeys for the program as well. So I'm going to be coming back to this particular IP to talk about certain points that I make during the presentation. I hope seeing a bit about what it has been will give all of you an idea of what the example is that I'm talking about. So moving on to a very critical part of this whole IP shipe conversation that I call it. What exactly is an IP? You know, we want to create one, but are we even clear what an IP is all about? If you use the term, if you Google it, there are certain words that will come up. Internet protocol, internet projects, intellectual properties from a legal perspective, which incidentally is this. So lot of it will talk about a company holding an intellectual property right. Nothing or almost close to nothing tells you about IPs the way we in the events industry think of this as a product. Usually when we talk in the events world, we tend to call any calendarized event as an IP. So if any activity is done year on year, whether it is done for ourselves, whether it's done for a client, it in our heads, we consider that a IP. The regularity of it being its lead characteristic. So that's how we look at the whole IP business and the IP piece. I would want us to take a little jump forward and look at it in a slightly different manner and look at it from the perspective of some of the biggest IP products that we know of. If you were to sit back and think about Superman, for example, or a Cinderella or a Mickey Mouse, all of them are IPs in their own rights and they all belong to Walt Disney. And in my head, he's like probably one of the first guys who really understood how this thing works. And he's managed to create this entire list of products, list of characters who have gone on to be on everything from watches to t-shirts to movies to music to having, you know, groups named after them, fan clubs, everything. That genre, that capability of creating a idea which is great content, which has the ability to create a community, which has an ability to give an experience which is so unique, so special, that even if it were not to be branded, if you are a regular at it, you would immediately identify it. That should be the crux of what really an IP is or ought to be. So in my head, I look at IPs as something which is very distinct content. I am not saying unique content. I am saying distinct content. Unique experiences, definitely. And it builds a community. Also, very, very importantly, it needs to be scalable. Whether scalable means geography, whether scalable means moving into various media, whether scalable means going into different formats, it could mean different things. But an IP, by definition, should be able to scale itself up into various formats, into various things. So if we are going to be creating an IP, if we are clear about what an IP should be defined as, I think the horizon opens up suddenly. You have far more to play with and work with, right? So moving forward, let's go on to the next slide, where we are basically talking about the masala. Since I started off the whole presentation talking about the secret ingredient, I thought, okay, let's stay in the genre and talk about all the things that go into cooking. So what is that masala? What are the things that you put in to come up with a awesome IP, right? So let's begin. The first thing, the first and foremost thing, is an insight. Now,
I'm sorry, Priyanka. I just have to 1 second. We can't see any screen. I think you're not sharing the screens with us.
Oh. Just a sec. Just give me a second. Open to the screen share.
Screen share is right at the bottom of your
screen. Yeah, I found it. I have clicked on it. Something's the matter. Wait. Is it visible now?
No, it's not.
Just give me a second, guys. I think there's a problem. I am clicking on share, but it's not sharing. Is it now?
Yes, now it is. Chalo IP pakaya. Yeah.
That's cool. Right. Yeah, yeah. So this is where I was basically talking about the intellectual properties and what it is defined as, the earlier conversation we just had. So moving on, I was coming to this piece where we speak about what all goes into making our IP in the first place. One of the most important things is an insight. Now, insights can come from anywhere, right? They can come from a movie, they can come from data, they can come from music, art, books, life itself, a lot of places. There are two issues when you work with insights. The first issue is there's so much happening. There are so many insights. There's so many trends that you identify. And many of them interest you. Now, how do you go about picking the right one or picking the one? Maybe all of them are right, but you can't be working on all of them at the same time. So how do you go about doing that is one issue. The other issue is, how do you really know that the insight that you're working on, the thought that you've had, is truly awesome or truly something which can be taken forward and developed into a full-fledged product which can live for a long time? So the way I do it is I look at it A, from the perspective of how excited do I feel with my own insight? What are the immediate arms and legs to it that I can think of and identify? And then, thanks to Google, it's much easier. I also Google up if there's something happening in a similar lines across anywhere. Most chances are anything that you think of is probably being done somewhere by someone. Doesn't mean that I can't do it. All it means is I go back to the drawing table and I figure out an aspect of it which is yet untouched, or which is still untouched in my geography or in the arena in which I wish to work. That is good enough to start working with, right? At this point, I would also like to mention something that I read long ago, and I'll paraphrase, I'm not good at remembering quotes. This is from David Ogilvy, and he had said something like, you know, big ideas come from the unconscious. And this is true in art, science, or even in advertising, or I would add even in IPs. But this unconscious has to be very well informed, so that the idea that you come up with is not irrelevant. So what that means is that delve into a lot of things, delve into a lot of conversations, talk about things, read about things which are not of any immediate interest to your professional lives, perhaps. What it will do is it will stay back in your unconscious mind. And when you are developing a thought, you will suddenly see something happening, a link coming back, which is not a thought through thing, but it like almost pops up in your head. So that's one of the things that you need to keep in mind, that the way to develop insights is to be delving into a whole lot of things. Like again, talking about David Ogilvy, he used to say that I look at life and it inspires me. If you look at life around you consciously, with a lot of curiosity, that itself will give you a lot of insights. Anyway, once you've got your insight, where do we go with that? The next bit of it is to actually plan it out as a concept. Where will you take it? How will it go? What all will it do? Be as imaginative around it as possible. Be as open about it as possible, and think through all the possibilities, everything that you could possibly be. At one point, it might look like you're thinking too far ahead of yourself, but don't limit yourself. Go ahead, think as big and as broad as you possibly can. If in case you are doing this as a team, if you're brainstorming, have what Josie Paul used to call his yes room, a room or a space in which nobody can say no to the other person. If somebody is building up an idea, what you can at best do is build on it. Even if you don't like what the other person is saying, you can't say, hey, I don't like that. That doesn't work. What you do is you build on it, or you take it in a tangent which you think is doable. So as a group, if you are brainstorming on a concept, do it with an open mind. Do it with the biggest vision possible. Create the biggest vision possible for the project that you have in mind. Don't think of how you will do it, where will the monies for it come, etc. Just think of the broadest plan. After that will come the turn of adding a sense of adventure. When I say a sense of adventure, what I mean is, usually when we concept plan, and many of us come from an even background, so what we tend to do is we start thinking, what is going to be the size of the stage? What kind of a prop will I plan? Those are the nitty-gritties we sort of dive into. Those can come later. At this moment, if we can plan it with a sense of adventure, if we can plan it with the thought of, if I were an audience or a reader or a participant in a project like this, what in it would give me the high? What in it would make me completely addicted to being a part of it? if we can plan those pieces, if we can think around those pieces and build them into our concept, I think that becomes the crucial hook which will ensure that I have my core TG in place. I have a certain bunch of people who will be hooked from day one, and they will then take forward the whole conversation and bring in more people into it, etc., etc. So that sense of adventure is very important. Going into nitty-gritties is absolutely important, but don't just block yourself with the nitty-gritties first. First plan the wows, then come down to how the wows can be manifested. So now is the time to manifest. Do your resource mapping. What I mean by resource mapping is everything, every element of the concept that you've planned, there will be certain resources you will need, certain people, certain organization, maybe certain technology. Read up on all of that, research on that, figure out who or what is it that you need to execute your plan in its biggest, grandest format. Also, start mapping the revenue that you need to make this come true. So this is basically where you wear your logical hat and you start thinking about what all do I need and how do I make it happen. When I say revenue mapping, you need to also figure out in whatever project you are creating, so what all could be the ways of getting monies in. Could it, sponsorships is of course something we all understand, but can there be ticketing revenue? Can there be merchandise revenue? Can there be revenue coming in from crowdsourcing because you are doing an activity which is more earth friendly or environment conscious or charity, etc., etc.? So would you like to crowdsource some monies? Projects which are hobby driven could be crowdsourced, for example. So things like that. Think of merchandising is a huge opportunity. So are there formats, are there ways in which you can figure out your revenue streams? Plan those. Now coming to the fifth point, which is almost the opposite of saying sense of adventure, but both are equally important, keeping it real. How do you've planned your magnum opus, but after that, how do you make each frame of that magnum opus come alive? What goes into creating it? What will make it sustainable? That is what you plan here. You also need to look at the parts which are awesome, but perhaps at this stage in the country, you don't have the right resources to do this. So you will have to park it somewhere. You will have to park those thoughts. You will have to park those ideas in some place and go forward and map the rest of it. You can't just drop the idea because one part of it is not doable at this instance. Nor should you try to put your energies into creating the resource for making it come real, because your project is about the IP that you're creating. Your project is not about creating the technology behind it, if you're not a technology company, I'm assuming, or the resource needed, etc. So keep it real, understand what your own possibilities and limitations are and work around that. Coming to the most important part of having a successful IP, the right team. Making of an IP is so much more than just an event, just a program, just a project. A IP by definition is a long playing activity which is gonna be there for years. It will be a Herculean task to plan. Think up one, plan one, and execute one, especially in the initial few years. You need the right team of people. These people have to be extremely involved, coming with different skill sets. At a point where if where they can very easily, without any egos coming into play, are able to, you know, share their thoughts, stand for certain things, vehemently oppose some other things. They need to be the kind of people who are able to look at the project as something that they own themselves. They're not doing it because it's a job that they need to do. They're doing it because they totally believe in it. They totally feel that, yes, this is the right thing to do and this is where we should be headed. That's the kind of people you need in your team. I've been really blessed to have a lot of my colleagues who've been hugely invested into the IPs that I've worked on. The one I gave an example of, for example, Times Kitchen Tales. I had in fact, the first deck that we made was made by my colleague called Shoma. And just to share an incident, initially when we made the entire deck, and we showed it to the bigger teams, we were flat out told that it doesn't work. No, this is too difficult and nobody will understand, no client will understand the deliverables we are delivering, etc., etc. So we heard a lot of naysaying. However, both me and Shoma totally believe that this project is doable. It has the right mix, and while yes, it's not been done before, I'm talking about BCCL as a framework, we had not executed something like this, but it definitely has its salient points, and once taken out to market and spoken to clients in the right format, we should be able to get through and make it happen and it will click. Year one, we kept pushing for it. We kept going out for meetings, asking for meetings. Things didn't turn out. We kept pushing it till year two. That is when actually the project, you know, saw the light of day. So you need the kind of team, you need the kind of people around you who have the conviction to push it with you, along with you, to a point where there is no other way but to succeed. So Shoma by then had moved on to another team. I had another colleague coming on board called Astha, and she took up the mantle immediately. So when we actually went into execution, it was Astha who was doing it. In fact, we didn't have enough monies to hire an MC, and she was literally my MC for the first 4-5 events, round events that we did. And she's never been an MC before, but she stood up and did it. It simply came from the feeling of knowing that, you know, I'm working on a great product, I'm part of a great product team, and it is working for us. So that's the kind of people you need around you. You need people who are positive and who make it happen for you, even at those times when maybe you are not feeling so confident about it anymore. So moving on. Ab hum banane ki vidhi ki baat karenge. So kaise banayenge? Okay, we've got all the ingredients. Now what do we do with all of that? So concepting, you know, is fun. It's like you can think wild, you can think all sorts of things. You can Google up all sorts of new technologies and bring it on the table and say, hey boss, we could be doing this, we could be doing that. And it's a lot of fun. The detailing of how is where the pain begins. The detailing is painful. But that's where we get in now. It's that process where you start chopping your onions, honestly. So there are tears and there is resentment and there's like, oh, I don't know how to do this. I've tried my best and I don't know where else to go for information. But then you dig deep and you find that information and you detail out your project to the last little bit, to a point where you are so ready with your product that if tomorrow you need to start off on it, you can. It is no longer in the vista of can be, should be, would be. It is there. It's physically there, literally on paper. If you have to start off, you can just go on with it. That's the level of detailing you need to do. Like I said, starting off, we visualize the entire project in a very optimistic manner. So let's start with creating a detailed plan also of that range of the product. Let's look at everything that can go into it and let's detail out every little bit. So if we are going to get international speakers, or if you are going to come up with a, you know, use a really used, very unseen as of yet technology, so be it. Let's figure out what the operational costs, what the time cost on all of this is and detail all of it. So moving from there, then comes the next step. What you start with it now is against each cost head that you've arrived at, you then figure out an alternate arrangement. What if I could find a way of not really paying for this particular service or product and talk to someone who owns it or runs it and get them on board in some manner so that my actual cash outs are controlled? What this does for you is it gives you a better sense of your first level of investors in your IP. These people may not be investing monies, but for some kind of a barter arrangement, whether it is communication, whether it is being able to talk to the right TG, which theirs and yours happen to marry. So all there could be various things that you could barter away. There could be various things that they are in need of. You need to be smart. You need to figure out what that alternate arrangement could be that works for both ends, right? And then after you've done that, then is the time to really get down there and start working on a second P&L. So what that second P&L does is from the grand plan, you now skim down to thinking of a more realistic plan. What if I don't get the entire funding for the magnum opus? So do I not make a film at all? Do I not go ahead and do anything at all? Of course not. So in the second setup, what we start doing is we cut down on all the frills. We cut down on all the things that we could possibly do without and bring it down in terms of revenue to a point where it seems a little more realistic. Both these P&Ls are absolutely necessary to do. You might think, why do I need to do a big one, grand one? Then let me just conceptualize it as a grand one and then come down and do a realistic P&L. That doesn't work. Why it doesn't work is, if you don't know what your big plan would cost you, you will not be able to bring it down to something which is more realistic, because there might be a point where a client says that, okay, your plan's fabulous and I want to do all of it. You will not be prepared to answer what that all of it costs. So you need to know what your big cost is and then also what your realistic one is, right? Coming to the screenshot that I had put up, Shylock was sharp, right? So I would say, be like Shylock, take every little drop, create every little thing out of any resource, any technology, anything. There are lots of things which are actually available almost for free, which you need to be cognizant of, and you should be able to utilize it in a smart manner to help your IP get across. It could be your social media, it could be other aspects. Be smart, be like really sharp about what are those elements which you want and can be had for no fee or very little fee. Plan your life around that, figure those aspects out and be sharp around it. So moving on, there are certain points that I feel we need to be really careful of when we are planning or we are getting into cooking up an IP. One of the biggest dilemmas that we face often is that of, my idea is not original enough, you know. I've come up with this concept. I have, and this is something, especially if you're in an organization where you are reporting into a lot of bosses, you will face this very often. You've got an idea, you're super kicked about, you work out some bit of details and you do a few slides or a Word document or whatever, and you take it up to them with full excitement that, okay guys, this is what I think we should be doing. And then one or the other person points out that, but there's something similar happening in Denmark or whatever, Jhumri Talaiya, doesn't matter, somewhere. chances are, like I mentioned earlier also, very few ideas will be absolutely fresh and never seen before. Most will consciously or unconsciously end up mimicking something that is already there in the world. So don't get disheartened. Just figure out how yours is a little different, or how yours is targeting a particular TG which doesn't have access to this kind of content. Just taking an example for marathons. There are enough and more marathons happening across the country, right? Across the globe, actually. But more marathons keep happening. And almost all of them, if handled the right way in terms of the, you know, the sports rules and the before afters, etc., are well attended. Which means that it's okay to be repetitive, provided we know who or what we are doing it for, and is it new or is it interesting enough for them to want to be a part of it, right? The second part, that second thing that we a lot of times get really stuck with is we want to do everything immediately. So like I said, plan your grand vision, but when you are then putting on your logical thinking hat, also break the grand vision into phases. Break it into, okay, launch, these are the three things we will do, because they are the absolute core of what we want to communicate. Post-launch, once we are going into season 2, season 3, season 4, whatever, maybe this is how we will keep scaling it up. This is how we will keep adding more value, more interesting elements, more maybe more geography. So plan it in phases. Do it in a way where you can, at least by keeping the first phase simple and to the core, you are able to push off with a start, with a launch. Because that's extremely important. If once you launch, you've seen some amount of success, you will get some amount of feedback, you will at least have something concrete to work with and then take forward. So plan yourself accordingly. Do not plan everything at the very beginning. Phase it out. A lot of times there's a lack of clarity in what a product really is. And one of the things we used to do in advertising used to be called brand personality mapping. And I remember we used to have these hilarious sessions where we would pick up a brand and then we would say, okay, if this brand be a woman, what brand of soap would she be using, or what brand of tea would she be consuming, etc., etc., etc. So we would actually create this entire personality around the brand and then work with that personality. We would almost assume the brand to be a human being. It would make a lot of sense for us to also look at IPs in that way. Think of them as certain kind of people. Who will do X but not be interested so much in doing Y. They might be into fitness, but they may not like yoga. Create that personality for yourself. What that will do for you is it will keep you chiseled, your thoughts chiseled to a certain set of people, because one of the biggest greed points in creating something like this is if you've got a slightly successful IP with you, a lot of brands or a lot of partners will come on board and say, hey, you've got this bunch of people or you've got this activity going. You know, we want you to just add in some other aspect into it. Again, coming back to Kitchen Tales, for example, we started out with Kitchen Tales as something which is for traditional Indian recipes. And we were focusing very much on the regional recipes. Now, a lot of brands have come to us and said, hey, but why just traditional regional Indian recipes? Why can't it be global? We've had conversations where we've been told that, you know, a cheese brand wants to come on board, but you will have to talk pasta and pizza. But then we've turned around, we've said, yeah, but not on Times Kitchen Tales. Maybe we can create another product for them, or we can do some other solutions for them. So we've actually opted out of it. Does that mean loss of revenue? Yes. Does that mean my IP stays true to its core? Also, yes. People who come and read on the project are very frequent visitors to our digital spaces, our on-ground spaces, expect certain things out of it. They have a certain idea because of which they respect that zone, they engage with it. If I were to bring in things which they are not so comfortable with, I would see a movement away, and it would dilute my core belief and my core product. So that's where we need to have that huge amount of clarity on what our project is or is not, right? I'm just taking a short break. This talking to my own screen is not something I do very often. I'm usually speaking in a room full of people where I can see heads nod and all of that. So, you know, bear with me. Many important things is also at times, and this is something I can tell you from my own experience, holding something too close to your heart. You know, and I tend to do a lot of that. What happens is maybe the project or the product really does need a change, which somebody is advocating. But because it in its own avatar is so dear to us and we hold it so close to us, our hearts, we are unable to see the demands of and the prudent demands of time and audience, and we do not make that change. We see this a lot happening, for example, with products which are very, products which have literary bigwigs on them. They hold the concept so close and so tight, they do not want to open up to ensure that a little bit of breathing space or a little amount of not so classic literature should find its way into the product. What it is doing essentially is it's stopping new audiences from joining a already successful piece. So while you should have clarity, you should also know how to distance yourself and see your product from a, you know, 30 feet up, 300 feet up vision to see what it really needs. Sometimes being too close to the product makes you blindfolded. One of the biggest things I find, especially in an organization which has some 10, 12,000 people, is traction with like-minded people. Until and unless your projects are being driven by not just you, but by some other people in the system, whether they be your teammates, but also certain senior people in the organizations, it can be extremely difficult to make any product come true, anything to really happen. There has to be belief, and you have to, as much as you will spend time in talking to external audiences about your product, I think it's also extremely important to have one-on-one conversations with people within the organization to make them understand exactly what it is that you're bringing on the table and how do you want it to go forward. Because without that, it's not going to work. Any IP, anything that you do, it's for the long haul. It needs a lot of support. So look at how you can bring that support around your product. The biggest challenge of all, no backers, no sponsors. How do you go about it? There can be a host of ways. If you figured out an insight which is really good, and you know that you can create some amount of content, you can have a good community around it, just go onto social media perhaps. Do a little digital piece around it and start getting traction around your concept. That done, you will be in a much better place to go back and then say that, hey guys, here is something we have done. This is what we've already created. Now would you like to come on board? this is for the sponsors. The other part is, if your content is really that good, do you want to charge people for it? Maybe another small way of getting some revenue in. So you need to also figure out around how, what if these things happen, what are the other things that you can be looking at? So coming to, I think, almost the end of my conversation, what, and this, in case somebody has a problem reading the headline, it says, Achhe Rasoiye Ke Saath Lakshan, which means if you were to want to be a good IP creator, curator, what are the things that you need to have in you? Like I initially mentioned, exposure to varied influences and experiences. Huge ability to multitask. Don't think it's going to be linear. It is all sorts of things happening at the same time. You need to have your cool. You need to be able to think around multiple things at the same time. Being a very practical, creative person. Taj Mahal banayenge, but uski neev kitni badi hogi aur kitni badi honi chahiye, ye humare ko pata hona chahiye. Right? And being a very creative, operational person. What that means is that I don't have the funds, but I need to do something because it's good for the project. Now, how can I creatively go around doing it? Storytelling and presentation skills. I think lockdown is a wonderful time for all of us to, you know, hone up on those skills. There are umpteen number of programs happening. Maybe look at those. And being a people's person. Talk to everybody, talk to anybody and everybody. You don't know who you will need as your support system to get your IP going. You will need your team members to spend 12 hours and then be willing to spend another 4 hours with you on the project. So genuinely be a people's person, understand their issues. It also gives you amazing insights, by the way, and stand by them so that they stand by you. The last, but I think the most important part of it is be tremendously curious. Be curious about how things happen. Be curious about why things didn't happen. Be curious about everything. That will give you the learning in a whole host of things. And those can come together beautifully at some point or the other in creating a product that is like really good. So coming to the last bit of my presentation, where did we talk about the secret ingredient? Wo to aaya hi nahi. Actually, there's not one, but two secret ingredients in creating a successful IP. And I quickly jump to that. The secret ingredients are passion and persistence. No IP is gonna become a reality till these two things are there in abundance. You really need to push for it. You need to believe in it. And you really need to keep pushing till somebody hears you and opens the door. So that's that. Anybody has any questions? I can answer those.
Priyanka, that was a really, really insightful session. There's so many things in this. There's so many, many, many things in this that really touch a chord with, I think, everyone who's here on this group. We have people, is the chat open on your screen? Can you see the chat?
Yes, I am. I'm just trying to quickly read through it. Just give me a sec. So
there's a couple of questions there, and there's going to be more questions here that you can just keep answering verbally.
I can see something from Vijay Sablok, who I think was your speaker in the last session.
Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. Fabulous.
What Vijay says here is, I'm just reading out, have you ever given a vendor or a service provider a stake to provide the service for free? Or in barter, what have you offered to cost down? So Vijay, actually, yes, we have looked at it like that. And while I can't divulge all the details of BCCL commercials here, but what I can tell you is that often a lot of vendors or a lot of service providers are also tremendously happy to be mentioned, because I'm talking from my perspective. I'm part of Times Group. And a lot of vendors are actually very happy if we mention them and we give them state space, etc. To handle some backend aspect for us, because you know that stage or that stature is something that they are then able to monetize to their benefit with other clients. And I'm sure that is possible on most IPs if done intelligently. Other questions, because there's a lot written. I'm just trying to find the. Okay. Anita Vadwani says, agree with too much too soon point completely. Okay. Glad. Personality profiling, great one. Guys, I see a lot of great point, etc. Thank you so much. I was so scared of taking this session because I couldn't honestly, you know, the first instinct when you're doing a presentation is to go online and look for content for it. And I figured that IP speak, there is no content. So whatever you have to do, you have to sort of, you know, just create. So I didn't know I had signed up for something as difficult as that, but I'm still trying to look for questions while I'm...
Priyanka, there's a question from Parjanya Adhikari, which says, what advice would you give to people just starting out? Must have, must do, and must avoid?
So so I'm assuming if you're just starting out as on wanting to create an IB and you're doing that as an individual, my sense of it would be figure out something which is very close to your own heart, because this is going to be a steep climb. If you're doing it only for the commercial benefit of it, you're probably going to lose heart very soon. So do something which is close to your heart. That also helps, because that means you are able to create and or at least filter content, because it's a subject you know yourself. Figure out like-minded people around you who can help you craft out the product better. And then see, like I mentioned, there are a lot host of free accessible ways of trying out content without going on ground, without going or even going on ground. You could do a small, say, conversation around it with 10 people in a cafe and figure out if what you're talking about, does that interest people? So start small, but figure out what it is you want to do. Create a roadmap for yourself and just get going with it. Don't wait for that golden day when the double rainbow happens. Just start off with it. And then you should be able to, you know, take it from there. Also, I think market it shamelessly. Talk to all your friends. Tell them you will stop talking to them if they don't market your piece, blah, 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 whatever it takes. Just go out, be a little shameless that way. Talk about it everywhere, every instance you get, and be almost like paranoid about it, and you will get there. And otherwise, you can always come and talk to me. And if the idea is nice, we can take it up at BCCL. That's another option. Yeah, are there more questions?
Option. So you're going to be like prompt with a whole lot of IP ideas very shortly. Yeah,
I don't mind. I don't mind at all.
Okay, so Maddie is asking, is there any course in India or abroad to study this in more detail?
I haven't really found one yet. I'm not saying there isn't, but whenever I've tried to look for one, I haven't found one yet. There are short courses on certain aspects of it, but nothing that is cohesively going to tell you how to build an IP. I think that happens because IP in its definition can be many things. You could have a music IP, which is completely different from a sports IP. FIFA is as much an IP as a, you know, whatever, I'm forgetting the name. So those things are. So it doesn't matter. A Lit Fest is as much an IP as a marathon is. So they're completely different products depending upon which genre you've picked up and how you're taking it forward. in today's world, it could be quite possible to do an IP which is completely in the digital domain and not at all with any kind of a ground output. So I don't know. There could be IP programs, but I'm not sure.
Okay, Nirav asks, how to carry on the reach post the IP till the next year?
Sorry, I didn't get that. Could you come again?
Nirav Chavla is asking, how do you carry on reach post IP till the next year? So I assume that means how are we sustaining a thought and how
right,
are we
I get
going till the next year?
I get that. So Nirav, there could be multiple ways. Stay connected with small, reunion meets of people who have been a part of the community through the year. You could also diffuse your IP into getting people to meet up on their own. Technically, you are not spending anything. You've just got the community together. And you can have a few spokes who will say, okay, hey, I'm here in Delhi, so-and-so is in Bombay, so-and-so is in Pune or Bangalore or wherever. Guys, let's get together for something. And while the conversation is happening around a group which has come together because of your IP, and the understanding with the spok is also that whatever happens there, a small note about it or a few photographs from it will go back onto your whatever digital space you have. But you've not really invested into it. You're not monetizing it. But these are all, remember, monetizable if you have the right client with you on that. So those could be some ways of looking at it. The other way, of course, is create content. Keep sharing it with your community. Keep talking about it. One piece which I think can work beautifully but is not often tried is we tend to see all other IPs or other programs in the same genre as competition. Say, for example, if I am doing a literary festival, I would look at a Jaipur Lit Fest as competition. I would look at a Shimla Lit Fest as competition, Chandigarh Lit Fest as competition, etc. But instead, if I were to look at them as collaborators, provide few of them, I'm not saying every one of them, but provide few of them, maybe a panel conversation on my main, event when it happens, I could also ask them to host my panels or my conversations on their events when they happen. So within them, there could be a short module, which is yours. And similarly, you do it for them. So what happens is the community, because the kind of people who are there are essentially the same people, the similar taste people, they could see you staying alive. They would know that, yes, this program is also there. It is a good way to act like a reminder medium. And you are collaborating. And I'm sure there's always a lot to learn from your competition also. So it actually enables that for you. Not that it happens too often. We are all kings of our own silos. Somebody has just asked, is it possible, JB Sahu, is it possible? Hello?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Okay. Is it possible today to create IPs without TV and newspaper? Very much so. Very much so. TV and newspaper are very expensive mediums. Yes, they reach out to the masses for sure. But if your IP is on a subject which is very niche, why would you want to be on television or newspaper and spend a whole huge chunk of money and then talk to everybody when clearly your audience is not everybody? You can use other mediums. You can use, you can even use TV and newspaper, but you can use it intelligently, not by just buying advertising there, but there are a host of other ways where you can intelligently weave in your content with these mediums. But yes, it's definitely possible. IPs can happen anywhere in any which format. It's not essential to be a television or newspaper or any large media based product at all. So Pinky Singh says, while working on one IP, we were just given a time of only 2 days and we couldn't come up with much. So according to you, does pressurizing work or giving the space and time works on IP? Pinky, I'm really curious of who can come up with an IP in 2 days. So I would love to meet those people. It is not possible. It clearly is not possible. Whatever be the subject matter of an IP, it needs a lot of delving into, needs a lot of thought. And while yes, you need to have certain deadlines, you cannot, especially if you're part of an organization, IP creation cannot be seen as a hobby which you will do by the by as and when you know, the inspiration strikes you. So you have to have broad deadlines, but the deadlines have to be far more rational than 2 days. 2 days is impossible. And I don't think pressurizing in this format really works. The max you could come up with is a possibly a event thought or a event plan in 2 days' time. I really don't see how you come up with an IP. From Vaishnavi Pandyan, how to handle rejection of ideas? Vaishnavi, ideas are a lot like our little babies, and it honestly feels very awful when somebody else rejects it. I think the best way to handle that rejection is, first of all, in your head, tell yourself very clearly that the person in front of you is rejecting the idea, is not rejecting you. And I am talking psychology, not really IPs. So if you can separate your idea from your own identity, it is easier to handle rejection, firstly. Secondly, what are the real reasons for somebody rejecting it? If they just come up with a flippant answer that this doesn't work, then don't take it too seriously. Of course, if it's your boss, then there's not much you can do about it. But in a better time, or when the person is in a better frame of mind or whatever, genuinely ask for the reasons of why the rejection was there. Evaluate each reason for what it is. If you think it merits, it is the right thing, then absorb it or use it to modify your idea. And if it actually dawns on you that while you were superbly excited about an idea, but it really isn't the thing, then be disengaged enough to get over it also. There's no point beating ourselves up over a particular idea which got rejected. It is better to think around it, modify it, and just move on. Your next question is how to scale it up consecutively over next years. Like I said, the simplest way of planning a scale up is think as broad as you can when you're on the designing table. Then break it into phases. The moment you do that, your game plan for the next 3 to 5 years should be in front of your eyes. As you move into year two, year three, your feedback, your ground research will automatically tell you where is the trend moving, what are the people who are part of the community that you have formed, what are they looking for, what are the interest areas, etc. So that will give you a sense of where forward you need to go or what are the little tweaks you need to do to your IP. Please remember, IP is a very very real, fluid kind of a project. It's not a open and shut thing. So it will keep evolving. Some evolution you will plan for it. Some evolution will come from the feedback and the ground realities. For example, many of our IPs right now, we have created e-versions of them, seeing we are right now in a lockdown situation. And this year, we're not expecting people to really throng the grounds, especially thinking, educated, literate people. We are expecting them to stay fearful of going into places which are too crowded. So we have actually evolved to create virtual pieces for our IPs. Now that is more necessity driven than what it was planned for the IP. But both those things should happen. But ideally, you should have a framework right at the beginning of what you wish to do with it. Let's see if there are more questions. Lavina, does this go on? I mean, or does this cut off somewhere? Like, I'm happy to answer. Just don't want it to suddenly
finish. You want it to cut off. We have no time.
No, okay.
But yeah, it would
be better. I just didn't want it to suddenly go blank. Okay.
So you can but maybe shortly, just so that everyone gets their sort of basic idea and just, you know.
Right.
Short answers, I think.
So there's a question from some old Maddie says some old case study concept presentation, sponsorship presentation. I don't get it. Is that a question, Maddie?
I think old case study concept presentations or sponsor presentations, which I don't think is possible from your side.
No, I can't. I'm sorry. I can't share internal stuff like that.
Question that's coming up from several people is about copyrights and trademark insights. So I think that's something
you
touch upon.
Yeah. Guys, for every anything which you think is more than a sporadic event, and you believe it is IP worthy, it is something you want to run with for the next 10 years at least, please go ahead and invest in getting your intellectual property rights in place. Talk to a lawyer, talk to legal teams, keep all your paperwork done. It sounds like a bit of a expense and who is really going to copy it, things like that. In India, we are a little lackadaisical about copywriting and stuff, but it is hugely important. And when you are at it, spend a little bit extra, but try to build in any and everything that comes to your mind. So while your IP today might be just a ground event, also buy out the copyright for merchandise, for music, for a cafe, for whatever else you can think of, because you may not know, but tomorrow you might need or want to extend the IP in that direction, and then you might already know that somebody already has it registered by that name. It doesn't matter if it's somebody is a small little guy somewhere with a one little activity, but if your IP is not protected, somebody really big could come in and do something very, very similar and get away with it. So it is really prudent to invest your monies and get your IP licensing done. I think there's a question from Shailesh Gopalan saying, for any sponsorships, the question that comes out is, what footfalls are eyeballs? And that's a roadblock as to how to measure or assume the same, as it's very debatable. Shailesh, it's not really that vague if you have planned out your media exposure completely. Because the moment you've done your media exposure, you should be able to mention what number of eyeballs you are getting at least. Once you've done the eyeballs, you can take a survey. And there are basic event industry numbers also there, which you can take for if X number of people have been reached, then a certain percentage of it is the kind of footfall we are expecting. And you can take the same percentages to work it out for the first time round. Or you could look at a similar product, maybe in a different genre, maybe in the same genre, in a similar market or the same market, and say that, okay, if this activity with XYZ in it had done this well or had this kind of footfalls, then we are expecting something on the similar lines or a little less or above, depending upon what your plan has really been. But you can definitely mention the eyeballs, if not the footfalls, if you have your media planned out well, because media will... whether print, television, radio, digital, everyone gives you the number of eyeballs or listenership, etc. And those numbers you can quote for sure. Lalit Keval Ramani says, how important is it to decide the location? I have seen any IP done away from BKC or Worli or South Bombay is considered a local event. Sponsorship becomes a challenge if the events are done by not being or hosting the event in center of the city. So, Lalit, totally depends upon the kind of event you are doing and what is it that you are bringing on the table? What is it that you are wanting to focus on? Are you focusing on a large number of people arriving for your IP? or are you looking for maybe a mid-sized number participating, but a very intense conversation or a very intense content is being developed there or work is being done around it. Also, it is location at, in many cases, is also a direct piece out of how much revenue you have, how much monies can you spend. If you're center of town, if you're at DKC or Worli or South Bombay, of course you will be spending a bomb on doing this activity. If you have the monies for it, great, awesome, why not? But another piece that I would want you to evaluate is, if you were to go into Navi Mumbai, for example, and do an activity there, the people there locally do not get too many things to witness of this stature. And you might actually get a better audience, and these are not, the quality of the audience would also not be too bad, because there's a whole host of cosmopolitan people who are living in those parts. So I know Bombay has this whole thing about being South Bombay enough or not. But if we can break the barriers in our own heads, I think there is a possibility that you can look at different locations. If, what is important is to figure out what is it that you want the product to do for you. Is it a mass event where you want hordes of people to come down no matter what? Or is it classy and you want a certain section of society to come in? Also, the kind of investments you're making, your deliverables to your sponsors if they're there. So all of this will decide what our location is. There are events which happen absolutely off track, and people spend monies to go there. A hornbill festival, for example, happens in one end of Northeast. People plan for it. They have it on their calendars. They buy the tickets in advance and they actually go for it. It's how it is marketed.
Another interesting question from Vijay. In post-COVID, with social distancing becoming more prevalent, how are you going to rethink large public IPs?
I may be a little too optimistic or whatever, but I think this whole COVID thing, while it is very scary and it feels like almost end of the world for a lot of us, but I think it will go off. In this whole thing of everything coming to a standstill that we are noticing, at max in 6 to 8 months, we should see it moving back to, a little cautiously perhaps, but moving back to where we were. At least in India, I think we are people who really revel in being a part of the community, being a part of larger organized, things. So for us to stay away and completely lock ourselves into our homes and just do the bare minimum necessary things, I don't think that can become a way of life for us. So firstly, I think you don't want to or you should not need to move all your mass IPs into a version which is lockdown relevant. However, having said that, it might be of interest to create little modules out of your existing content or some fresh content and share it with your communities, because this is a time when they're sitting at home with some amount of free time and not much to do. So it might be a good time to reconnect back with them and give them something meaningful to engage in. But completely changing around ideas to fit into, end of the day, I don't see IPL or a FIFA not happening because of, ever because of COVID. If that is true for them, then it should be true for our IPs as well. It will get blocked, it will get postponed, but then things will go back to normal.
Okay, I think that maybe okay. We can just take a couple of questions more and then...
I think there's one question from Webhav Varnekar which I would like to answer. He says, how do we save our concept or idea by not getting copied or replicated? Webhav, that's a very interesting question. I think this whole thing of being copied or replicated is something that the entire industry, especially in India, we suffer from it a lot. One of if you think your concept is really good and it's really something you don't want to getting copied or replicated in any manner whatsoever, then please go ahead and get a copyright done on the idea itself. That's quite possible. It doesn't have to be a product per se to get a copyright on. Get it copyrighted wherever, whenever you are showcasing your concepts. Please make it clear. Put a big note there saying that, you know, this is completely copyrighted. It is a legal copyright that has been done, and no part of this can be replicated in any manner whatsoever. More of us in India need to do that for others to start, respecting ideas and giving due credit where it's due. So do we have anything else, Lavina? Anything, any other question that you think is... I see something from Kan Trivedi, which says, while making a pitch for IP, can you please share your views on how a presentation flow should be like? Or does it vary basis each product? Kan, it completely varies depending upon the project that you're doing. You could start with an insight. You could start with a story. You could start with saying, here is what I'm gonna do, and then it is completely storytelling. Your pitch IP could work any which way, but some of the things that you would want to definitely end of it share are a couple of slides very clearly on what your media deliverables would be, very clearly what the sponsor can expect to get out of it, what kind of customizations are possible, what are the absolute no-nos, if any, that your project has. If you can clarify those points, I think the rest of your pitch deck can be any format. It can be a document, it can be a PPT, it can be a video. You can play around with all kind of forms. Yeah, that's it.
Thank you, Priyanka. This was really, really
thank
great.
You so, thank you so much, Lavina. Yeah.
I think that maybe if you can just put in...
And I think
I'm thinking if you can put in your LinkedIn LinkedIn ID or something here, so maybe people who want to sort of get in touch with you can follow you. Maybe if you share your LinkedIn ID or something here, that could be good.
Just give me a sec. I'll just open it and cut it paste onto the conversation. Is it visible? I've put the link there.
No, I can't see it here.
You can't see it, no? Wait a sec.
On the chat.
I'll just put it up on the deck. Does that help you guys? No, no. Lavina, I'll just share it with you. Will you put it up?
Yeah, sure.
I don't know, for some reason I'm unable to do it. Huh?
So in the chat, I think if you just type in your LinkedIn ID, it should just come up.
I know, that's what I was doing, but for some reason it's not going through. I'm just sending it to you on WhatsApp. If you can just put it there. I think that my chat, this thing is looking like it's locked, like it's got blocked or something. I've just WhatsApped it to you. You've got that?
Yeah, got it.
Yeah. Cool then. Thank you so much, people. And thank you, Lavina. Thank you, Eventpreneur.
Thank you.
This was my first ever webinar. So I was really excited and nervous at the same time. I hope I wasn't too awful.
Thank you. That was a beautiful session. Thank you, Priyanka. Looking forward.
Thank you.